You know how a choral school looks like this? Well, realistically, you're going to be writing for something that looks like this. In the last episode, I mentioned that realistically, you're going to be writing for a choir that consists mainly of mezzo-sopranos and baritones. It's worth looking briefly at these voice types, but as a general rule, singers will train themselves to sing well in either a high or a low range. If you're using the ranges I suggested, there really shouldn't be any issues when it comes to range, because your singers will just choose the range they're most comfortable singing in, and if it's not working, then they'll ask to switch. But for the sake of completeness, let's have a look at the mezzo-soprano and baritone voice types. And while we're at it, let's look at some more specialized or obscure voice types you might encounter as well. Mezzo-soprano, or just mezzo for short, means half-soprano, with the implication being that they're halfway between alto and soprano. Most women's voices will fit the mezzo-soprano voice type, which, for a standard singer, will lie roughly between A3 and F5. Mezzo-sopranos who sing high will be able to cover most of the soprano range, though usually not higher than A5. If you're writing your arrangements correctly, this will actually cover all of the notes you'll be using for the female voice parts, save some of the extremes on either end. Whenever you get into the extreme ranges, I recommend splitting the parts, so that your true sopranos and altos can shine, and the mezzo-sopranos that complete the parts don't have to strain by singing outside of their comfortable ranges. Oh yes, I've not talked about splitting parts yet, have I? It's actually really simple. If you want to split your sections in two, all you do is you assign your singers as either one or two, with ones taking the higher part and twos taking the lower part. So, for instance, with your sopranos, your soprano ones will sing the higher part and your soprano twos will sing the lower part. Simple. Next, let's take a look at the male counterparts to the mezzo-sopranos, the baritones. Much like mezzos, baritones are halfway between bass and tenor. The word baritone means deep or heavy sounding, but don't be fooled by this. Many baritones excel in a high range rather than a low range. Lower voice baritones are called bass baritones, and higher voice baritones are informally called baritenors. Baritones can generally sing between G2 and E4, and higher baritones will be able to sing up to G4. Most of your male singers will be baritones, so try to keep the arrangements within this range, and, like with the female parts, split whenever you decide to use the extreme ranges, so your true tenors and basses can show off. As you can see, there's only about a fifth at the bottom and a fourth at the top that are missing from the baritone range when compared to the bass and tenor ranges. So, if most singers are mezzo-sopranos and baritones, why don't we write a choral score that looks like this? As I mentioned before, the vocal parts on your score should be treated as just that, parts rather than types. There is an element of tradition here, but you could just as easily list the parts like this, and it would still make sense. Oh, and as a side note, try to not give the tenors a part in bass clef, because they tend to hate that. The only situation where I would recommend using a dedicated mezzo-soprano or baritone part is if you want to split the men or women in three parts rather than two or four. The musical director or conductor will then choose who sings what. After all, they need something to do too. Let's look at some specialized voice types now. One I hinted at in the previous episodes is the male voice type that favors singing in head voice, the countertenor. Countertenor is a term used in medieval music, meaning against the tenor, which has been appropriated to mean man singing in head voice in modern times. Range-wise, they're roughly equal with altos, and, in my experience, they will prefer to sit with the alto section in choirs. It can lead to some challenge with blend, but countertenors will usually have a softer sound than female alto singers, as they're singing in head voice rather than chest voice, so it should work fine in most cases. Countertenors are common in classical music, especially in Baroque and earlier music, and many pop singers also fit the countertenor voice type.
I've got two of my friends from the LPC here, that is the Philharmonic Choir in London. They are countertenors. This is Noel and Andrei. And I've convinced them to come and show us what countertenors might sound like. So, how are you guys?
Good.
You good?
Yeah. Thank you.
Are you excited or nervous?
Absolutely. Very excited.
Very excited?
Slightly nervous.
Slightly. So, what are you guys going to sing for us today?
Oh, gosh. Well, we are going to be singing an excerpt of Pergolesi's Stabat Mater. Just the first movement, or a bit of the first movement. We'll attempt to.
No, that'd be great. So let's hear it.
Well, I think what's interesting, you know, before we get into that, is that, you know, the Stabat Mater, the Pergolesi Stabat Mater, which is gorgeous, you should definitely listen to the whole thing, is written for soprano and alto.
Okay.
So, you know, here you have two countertenors attempting to sing a soprano and alto part, so you'll see how that sounds.
I'm sure.
I'll be attempting the higher part.
Yes. I'll be Noel on soprano and Andrei on alto. So, tell me if you've heard this one before.
I don't have enough tenors. I asked some of the bassists to sing tenor, but they just started crying. Oh, I know. I'll ask some of the altos to sing tenor. They sing low, so it'll sound great. Right?
Ah, yes. The female tenor. Not really a voice type as such. Female tenors exist more out of need than anything else, as, for some reason, there simply doesn't ever seem to be enough male tenors around. Now, while I appreciate that you sometimes just need to get the numbers up in your tenor section, I don't recommend using women in your tenor section in a mixed choir setting if you can avoid it. The problem is twofold. It's difficult to blend a male and a female voice singing in unison, since both parts will be singing in chest voice with very different timbres, or sound qualities. Also, very few women are able to project well when singing down in the basement. True altos are quite rare, much like male singers generally lose their projection as they get into the extreme low range. Singing low notes requires rather relaxed vocal cords, which hinders projection, and this applies to both men and women. However, if you need to use women in your tenor section, try to keep the tenor part at G3 and above, as this will give the ladies a fighting chance when singing the tenor part. However, like I mentioned in the episode on sopranos and altos, you can use the women much lower in an all-female ensemble, as there won't be any male voices obscuring them as they get low in their voices. Now we've talked about most voice types you'll encounter in your arranging work, but I'm giving you very general information here that will apply to most arrangement situations. Maybe your choir does have a man who can sing as a soprano, or maybe you've got a woman who can rival the basses. Exceptions don't make good guidelines. You'll have to decide what to do in situations like these on a case-by-case basis, as, after all, no two choirs are going to be the same. One last note. Children's voices. These are referred to as trebles, and are roughly equal with mezzo-sopranos in range. There is, in my opinion, no need to differentiate between boys' and girls' voices until they reach puberty, though there are slight differences. Girls' voices won't change as significantly as boys' once they reach puberty, but once a boy's voice breaks, it's important to not strain his voice until it is settled, as it'll be difficult to control.
Are you sick of my voice yet? We haven't even started looking at the actual arranging process yet. However, now that we've looked at the instruments we're using, we're ready to start looking at how to arrange a song. In this first series, I'm going to be looking at how we do it, start to finish. I'll be looking at more advanced topics at a later time. However, feel free to make comments and suggestions, and I'll do my best to look at them as we go along. Anyway, I'll see you in the next episode.